My name is Andrew von Nagy. I do a little bit of blogging, a little bit of Twitter, and sometimes work on the side. I gave a talk last year at this conference around the theory of capacity planning, because what I had found was I was running into a lot of customers with a lot of networks that were designed for coverage only, and they're having a lot of influx of devices, and they're still only designing for coverage. Or they're designing for capacity, but doing really a very poor job at it. And so I've been focusing recently, the last year or so, on how do we mature as an industry around capacity planning? And so that's kind of what I want to give you today is, last year I gave you the theory. The video is out there and archived. You can go look it up. I'm going to go over the brief background of the theory and add a little bit of flavor to that today. But I really want to get hands-on into my methodology around the design of a network, how I integrate capacity planning, and give you an example. I'm not saying this is the right methodology. I'm just saying we need to mature as an industry. And this is my way of kind of promoting that goal. And I'm open to discussion as well around how you guys plan for capacity, tie it into your RF and coverage planning, and to make a network successful with all the devices you have coming in. So that's really the goal of this presentation, just to share my methodology and walk you through how I do it. So on the agenda, I'll talk about some of the basic network performance concepts, where capacity is really dictated in a wireless network, and how we get from point A to point B to knowing we need capacity to actually delivering on that. Going through my design methodology that I've kind of developed over time to design networks for a large amount of devices or a large amount of throughput. Introduce you to my capacity planner tool, not to promote it or anything, but this is kind of what I've worked into my process, and if it worked for me, maybe it'll work for you, and that's kind of why I just put it out there. And then to go through an actual example with you. So to start on a little bit of background, let's just take step back from Wi-Fi for a second to say what impacts network performance for all telecommunications and networking, right? And it really comes down to two things. It's bandwidth and latency. Latency has been very forgotten as of the last decade. I would say the focus is always on increasing bandwidth, increasing speeds in order to increase performance. But lots of times you find that latency impacts your user experience much more so than having a very high-end throughput. And Martin Geddes, who's from the UK, has an excellent article on the three types of delay that you can experience in a network. Geographic delay, packet serialization delay, and variable contention delay. And he goes through what he calls like the three epochs of telecommunications. Back in the day, we had very slow dial-up links. There's a large geographic delay between sites. We've improved that by getting communications working at the speed of light across fiber optics. The RF speeds that we see are near the speed of light. We really can't minimize that geographic delay anymore, especially when we're talking, and we actually bring this into Wi-Fi, is between the RF link between a client and an AP really is fixed. You can't transmit the wave through the air any faster than it already goes. So what's left? We can try to optimize the serialization delay. That's what we get through higher order modulation. 11AC brought us with 256 QAM. And we can also do that through multiple spatial streams. But we're approaching the limits of where those can take us. 256 QAM to get the highest end 11AC data rates, you have to be very, very close to the access point or have a very, very strong signal and signal-to-noise ratio. Realistically, this translates into somewhere between typically 15 to 20 or 25 feet from the access point or less. And for most enterprise wireless networks, you can't realistically design to achieve that modulation for all your clients. So what I'm just saying is that we've increased the bandwidth and the speeds through spatial streams and through higher order modulation about to its limits. We're just providing very, very little incremental value at this point for a very small subset of clients that might be really close to the access point. So the big driver of performance improvement in our wireless networks now is actually minimizing contention delay, minimizing that latency of how can I get on access to the air and how can I transmit. And if I can't transmit and I have to wait, that impacts the user experience and it also impacts the actual performance of your network. So here's just highlighting how we've decreased the serialization delay through faster and faster speeds and modulation. So when we actually improve bandwidth, we're actually decreasing the packet serialization delay is what we're typically doing. They're very, very closely related. So everybody knows wireless network capacity is built on multiple factors, single client throughput, multiple client throughput, coordinated APs, co-channel interference, external interference from other access points, external interference that may raise the noise floor from non-Wi-Fi sources. We need to take all that into account. And what I showed last year was really the main drivers of kind of the knobs we can tweak to play with wireless network capacity. On the positive side, we can add more spectrum to our spectrum inventory. The more spectrum we have, the more essentially contention domains, to reference Chuck's talk from yesterday. The more contention domains we have, the more clients we can segment into smaller groups, and the whole aggregate performance and aggregate capacity of our network increases. We can also do it through spectral efficiency. That's higher signal quality to our clients so they can use the higher data rates, as well as clients that support multiple spatial streams to be able to transmit all that data in parallel rather than kind of more serially with one spatial stream. RF interference, you guys know what that is. I'm not really going to go over that. But the one I want to focus on today is medium contention. So there are two factors that really play into medium contention. The first one is co-channel interference. The more APs we have operating on a given channel or frequency and within range of one another, the more they share the bandwidth. So our capacity is essentially per channel or per cell capacity, just like Chuck referenced yesterday as well. If the APs are on the same channel within range of one another, they share the capacity, plain and simple. And so I see so many wireless networks that go in, and especially in 2.4, they have APs stomping over one another because they think, I put in more APs, I get more capacity. But if they share the same channel, you don't do anything. You're sharing the capacity of that channel. So adding APs that overlap with one another really doesn't improve your capacity situation for the wireless network. You guys know all about that one as well. The typical rule of thumb, I would say, which you should definitely be designing to confirm, in an enterprise network with typical omni antennas is you need around 4 access points or more on non-overlapping channels in order to have a viable channel plan. There's a lot of theory and mathematics around that, and it doesn't fit in every situation, but from a baseline expectation, if you're looking at a typical enterprise environment where you're looking at your channel plan of multiple access points, try to achieve at least a minimum of 4 non-overlapping channels. The problem we get stuck with is our spectrum inventory, and 2.4 only gives us 3, so immediately you can't achieve that in 2.4. And in 5 gigahertz, we have a kind of the opposite situation of we have plenty of channels, but people start to play with channel widths and inadvertently enable 80 megahertz on their wireless network, and so you go from 9 or 12 non-overlapping channels down to like 2 or 4, and you start to get into that barrier where it could become a problem again. So that's just be very, very careful about the larger channel widths. And getting back to that spectral efficiency, using wider channel widths, like Chuck said yesterday, I'm referencing a lot of Chuck, by the way, because our presentations are based off the same fundamental concepts, and he nailed a lot of it yesterday. The more contention domains you have, the more you can segment those users. The wider channel widths actually group users into much larger groups, and they all share that bandwidth. And so you're just increasing your contention domains, and you run into a lot more medium contention-related issues. The second form of medium contention is really airtime demand or utilization within a channel or within a cell. And what we want to do is we want to go from a large clump of users and start breaking them up into smaller contention domains. So what was it, 15, 20 years ago, we had Ethernet networks that were shared hub-based networks. What did you do? We started putting in bridges and breaking up those contention domains. Well, Wi-Fi is a shared medium. We need to break up those contention domains as much as we can, and we do that by segmenting users onto different channels. You know, probably so far this is a lot of just review for the basics everybody knows, right? The question that I bring and I have for you guys is, where is the breaking point? How many clients are you planning for in your wireless network that can be within one contention domain or one channel before you think that that channel is saturated and can't support any more users? Anybody have any thoughts? Depends on the applications and bandwidth requirements. I would agree, and I'll show you why. Anybody else have any thoughts? Depends on the modulation. Like signal to noise for the client and what data rate they're getting and. I don't think that's on, by the way.
I tried blowing in its ear, it didn't work. It depends on the modulation type of the client, right? 802.11ac versus 802.11n versus 802.11bgn.
Right.
Each of those are going to have different tolerance levels as well.
Right, so a lot of capacity planning actually ties back in directly with RF and coverage planning. You want to have good, strong signal to your clients so they can achieve higher data rates, higher modulation, and multiple spatial streams if they're capable. So the whole question for me that I've been pondering over the last year is, how do I take those application and bandwidth requirements and work that into a model for capacity within a single channel or a single Wi-Fi cell, and also tie it in with RF planning to make sure that I've got the two integrated, because designing a correct wireless network, you need to integrate both the RF and the capacity planning. So the breaking point actually varies based on what type of data you are passing. Are you passing, and specifically which WMMQ it's falling into. If you're looking at WMM best effort and background, they actually can achieve much higher aggregate throughput in a cell with higher client counts and client loads than you can with voice or video. And this is kind of counterintuitive. Most people think, I've got QoS, I'm prioritizing voice and video, that means I should be able to fit a lot of those devices into the network. And actually, if you look at the way the MAC protocol is written with 802.11, what you find is that the contention window is the priority mechanism for those applications. And how we prioritize them is we take a contention window from data that is very large by default, at its default size, and for voice and video, we start to compress that contention window down so it gets quicker access to transmit. But if there's a large amount of stations, the probability of those clients then colliding in their transmissions grows dramatically once the client count goes up. So actually what you find is with a dense client user base, as density grows, voice and video queues actually perform much worse than best effort and background queues. And it's very counterintuitive. So this graph actually is from COMSIS, which they've done a whole QoS kind of white paper on 802.11 and stressing the need for improvement in our QoS mechanisms. But this is for a given load per client. So the clients are along the bottom there. And as the number of clients grow, each essentially trying to request about 3% airtime utilization. The breaking point for best effort is somewhere between 75 to 80% of utilization. And this is what I found through my testing as well. You know, doing lab testing, like throwing a whole bunch of iPads, doing streaming video on a single access point. About the limit that I can saturate airtime in a cell is between 80 to 90%. With a few clients, I can get closer to 90. If it's UDP traffic, I can get a little bit higher than TCP traffic, but once I get to larger client counts, because of contention-related overhead and back-offs and retransmissions and control overhead, like Chuck mentioned yesterday, you start to see that you can't saturate the airtime quite as much for actual data traffic. So my barometer right now that I typically use is for best effort data traffic. I don't want to go beyond about 75 to 80% airtime utilization. That's where I start to see clients causing all sorts of contention problems. Now, it's not a hard client count. And one of the things I want to dispel out there is a lot of people do very rough guesses on how many APs do I need? Well, let's budget for 15 clients per radio or 30 clients per AP. If you don't know what they're doing, that number could be spot on, it could be completely off. It's just a guess. And so rather than guessing, I'd rather try to put some effort and work behind it to figure out for every customer that I touch, where's my breaking point going to be and how do I design that network? The other thing is for voice, if you've ever tried to load, if you're in a hospital environment or a heavy voice over IP environment, and you try to load a large amount of voice over IP clients on an access point, the breaking point is typically much lower as well. I think Cisco's recommendation back in the old BG days was somewhere around 12 to 14 concurrent calls. With the new 11N and AC stuff, it's moved up to about 27 per radio. And you think, well, voice is a very low bandwidth application. Why can't I get more than 27 calls on one radio? It's the access delay. They're all trying to get into that smaller contention window and transmit at the same time. And once you start loading up enough clients that are packing into that WMM voice queue, just that contention window needs to grow. And it continually grows and shrinks because clients try to access the channel and they're all at the same priority. So we measure capacity within a cell. I'm going to kind of focus on the in-cell capacity, not the co-channel interference mitigation. I think you all know how to design around co-channel interference, why it's bad. I want to focus on within a cell, how many clients can I pack in there? And it's all completely based on airtime demand. And you get into this deep well of, well, what dictates how much airtime every client's going to use? That's dependent on a lot of variables. It's dependent on what the channel width is that the client supports and is configured on the access point, how many spatial streams it supports, what the signal quality to Sam's point was, determines what data rate, my data rate adaptation algorithm, the protocol that the client's using and the mix of protocols of clients on your network. Do I still have, you know, old 11G or 11A clients on my network? Heaven forbid you don't have 11B anymore, although I have run into that. What frequency bands they support? Are you buying 2.4 only devices? Stop it. Please don't buy 2.4 only devices. Do your devices support DFS? Can they use those channels? Can you use those channels in your infrastructure? And the application throughput that they are trying to achieve. I mean, are people doing email, or are they doing voice over IP? Are they doing large file transfers? Are they streaming video? What are they trying to do on the network will drive how much airtime and how much they are trying to transmit or receive. So what we want to do is we want to boil this down from a very complex set of variables into something that's, you know, realistically achievable for most network admins to say, how many APs do I need? Just tell me, right? So the method that I've developed is essentially trying to figure out what clients are doing on average on the network. You add them up together, you hit your barrier of 75 to 80% if it's just best effort data traffic, and you can do some rough calculations on how many APs you need. This is a predictive modeling type of method. This is not 100% accurate, just to put that out there very upfront. I want to get a baseline of how many APs I need based on my variables on my network for pricing considerations, bill of materials considerations, and I actually dovetail this right into my RF planning as a starting point for how many APs I plop on a blueprint and start to, you know, figure out where I need to place them and how I need to develop my channel plan. This is not an absolute number of what you need. Oops, apparently I have some animation in this one. Wasn't intended. So my methodology kind of goes through this workflow. I talk with the customer, I set goals. What do you want to use the wireless network for? What business applications require the use of the wireless network? What's your primary objective for having the wireless network? This gives me just a frame of reference of this is what's critical to deliver for this customer. If it's, warehousing, they've got, warehouse management systems. That's my critical application. I need to make sure that's working. If it's an office environment, maybe it's just generic productivity, right? People have to communicate via email. We go to meetings. They bring their laptops. They do some file transfers. I just need to know what means success for this customer. Then I go through a requirements gathering process with them. Okay, what types of client devices do you have in your environment, and what are they doing? So do you have a lot of laptops? Do you have a lot of tablets? Do you have a lot of smartphones? What's the mix? Do you support BYOD or not, right? And so what I find is typically there's a mix. There's a lot of laptops, but then maybe a lot of BYOD in an office environment, and they can bring in whatever they want. And it's not critical to understand the exact models and makes and everything like that. I'm just trying to get a feel for the client mix overall and their capabilities. I do my capacity planning by putting in some variables around what I showed you earlier, around what applications they're using and what their capabilities are, to get a t-shirt estimate of how many APs I need. I throw that into predictive modeling to start modeling my RF coverage as a starting point. And then I actually do the install, and I do the verification survey to make sure there's, you know, no co-channel interference and things are designed to my spec, right? And so my methodology really is using capacity planning in combination with coverage planning and site surveying in order to come to a good design. And I really use it as a starting point. I don't really use it for anything other than that. Because when I'm walking in and I'm looking at a blueprint, if it's a stadium, like Chuck said, well, they're going to pack as many cells or contention domains into that area as possible. But I get into an enterprise environment and, you know, I could pack in way more APs than they probably need. Or I could pack in way fewer access points than they need based on coverage. My whole thing is along that spectrum of coverage-oriented designs to high-density stadium type of designs, where those are at the extremes. Most enterprises and most wireless networks fall somewhere on a grayscale in between. And I'm just using capacity planning to set my barometer of where in that grayscale am I. Are they a heavier deployment where I think I need more APs, or are they a little bit lighter? Because it's just every customer in every environment is different. And I really am not a big fan of using just guesses around clients per radio, clients per AP, or APs per square footage, because that doesn't tell you the whole story. I mean, I could put in one AP per 3,000 square feet. Guess what would happen if we did that in this room and we had all the seats full and I had, two, maybe three APs in here? And everybody was trying to do, you know, high-def video streaming of a live presentation or something, right? It just doesn't capture the use case by trying to do it based on, you know, a square footage model. So that's what I'm trying to do, is I'm trying to capture the use case. And so what I really recommend as well is doing this in an iterative approach. So I do my capacity planning, and I use that as the starting point for my RF modeling. And if for whatever reason the two aren't in alignment, let's say I have my capacity plan come out with very few or very little access points because there's actually not a high def use case or a lot of bandwidth going across the network, but my RF plan says, well, I'm not going to have coverage everywhere. Okay, so I start adding in APs for coverage to get coverage everywhere. Or take the opposite of, I've got a capacity plan that says I need a lot of APs. We've got a very demanding user base. But I can't fit all of those into my RF design without causing co-channel interference. I go back to my capacity plan and start tweaking variables and running what-if scenarios to figure out, okay, I need to, you know, reduce the amount of access points that I need to still meet this bandwidth requirement. How can I do that? Can I change channel widths? Can I design to a different signal quality? Can I switch access points? Or maybe even worst case is that's just not realistic in that environment unless I do more advanced RF design and start doing directional antennas and breaking up contention domains through other physical means through my RF design. And so what I do is I just iterate between the two. Lead one into the other, can you make it work? If not, revise. And that can be revising the capacity plan, revising user expectations downward of you're just not going to get 20 meg per device in this environment unless we do directional antennas. Oh, I don't want to do directional antennas. Okay, we have to lower your expectations. We could make it work if we did it this other way, but you have other reasons that are overriding that. So I just wanted to show you real quick what the capacity planner looks like and kind of what how we plug in some of these variables. So I'm going to give you a brief overview of the capacity planner, and then I will give you an actual example here in a minute. Actually, let me see if I can just mirror it to both. Give me one second. Okay, let me zoom out a little bit.
The projector will do 1080p whenever I change
resolution. Oh, it will? Maybe. All right, there we go. Thank you. Maybe I'll zoom in a little now. Okay, so essentially there's three sections to the capacity planner. The top section is really around your network infrastructure and some of your design goals. So you plug in what access point you want to use, what channel width you're more than likely considering for use on 5 GHz. Understanding that not all of your clients are going to be online at the same time. So there's some concurrency limits or variables you can configure here. And I usually tell people that if you have an existing wireless network, understand how many users and devices you have in your network versus what you're seeing online at peak times at any one point. And you can get a pretty good estimate of what your concurrent user base looks like versus peak or versus deployed. You know, how many SSIDs, how many data rates, some of that gets into overhead background for beacons and network management. And then the RF coverage design really ties into what are you designing the network to from a signal strength level. So the capacity planner doesn't integrate directly with any RF site surveying tools like from Air Magnet or Ekahau or anybody, right? This is a spreadsheet-based tool. I'm not a developer. I wasn't going to, you know, write integration code. Frankly, UC and the Ekahau guys are doing some of this themselves as well in their code, and I think it's great. But for my purposes, the way I'm tying the two together within the capacity plan is understanding what you're designing the network to from a signal strength level. So if I'm designing for capacity, voice, or location, that's maybe a neg 67 dBm everywhere. So I know clients should be able to achieve a neg 67 throughout the environment. And by the way, all of this is customizable. They're supporting worksheets where you can go in and define your own, like what type of coverage or your own AP if you want, and its capabilities. So all of this is customizable in the other worksheets. The main worksheet kind of just ties it together, and you make your selections. The RF environment really tells you some key characteristics about your environment, like what is the noise floor. So you should take some measurements on your environment. I have some pre-canned ones in there from what I found to be most typical of these types of environments, of what your noise floor is, as well as then if you have a lot of airtime utilization from essentially other sources like neighboring Wi-Fi networks. So if you're in a multi-tenant situation, you probably have a lot more co-channel interference than if you were in kind of an isolated area or suburban area. And then the second section here is just going through and you pick out, so you sat with the customer, you understand kind of what types of devices they have, and you start plugging them in. Okay, I've got X number of laptops and they're doing typically file sharing. It's not heavy file sharing. Maybe they're doing some YouTube streaming. They do some casual web browsing and they do email. You start to plug in your clients and what applications they're using. You can have one or multiple applications per client that you want to plan for. So if you have multiple applications, so you know these are all smart devices these days. They can do things in the background while they're also, you know, user focus is somewhere else. So they can be doing email, and in the background, they're also doing an FTP file transfer. Who knows, right? You check the little box on the left, and it copies the device and the quantity, and you plug in another application that's running in the background, and you can do as many background applications running concurrently on a device that you want to plan for. So this one, let's say, you know, I've got some smartphones, I've got laptops, a couple different flavors. Some are newer, some are older, based on maybe, you know, my device refresh or lifecycle planning. And then at the end, at the bottom, you get your results. And there are a couple of options you can pick from to start doing the what-if scenario analysis. By default, it will put the AP or the client capacity evenly between both radios. But you can get more sophisticated saying I have more 5 gigahertz channels available. Why don't I band steer and start shifting a majority of my clients over to 5 gigahertz? And one of the features that I really worked pretty hard on with this was this distribute capacity based on the number of available channels. And what I want to do with that setting is saying I want to use every channel available to me before I start reusing channels. Because once I start to have to reuse channels, then I have to be very careful with my RF design, and I have to start avoiding co-channel interference. So if I distribute based on the channel inventory, and you can configure which bands you're using and how many channels at what width, you click calculate, and you can see we went from 4 and 4 to now I should plan for 5 gigahertz radios and 2 2.4 gigahertz radios in this, you know, mock-up. And that would allow me on that ratio to say, okay, I can avoid co-channel interference if possible. You get a breakdown of how much throughput at peak. So if all these clients are going at once to your concurrent value limit, this is what you'd expect from a backhaul perspective. So you can accurately size, let's say, your internet link or your WAN link, assuming this is the only traffic. If it's not, then you might have to add to it for other traffic. Gives you the band steering ratio you should expect on APs that have both radios enabled, and gives you some breakdown on a per radio and a dual radio AP basis. So that's really the basics of, you know, the main capacity planning is understanding your environment, understanding what infrastructure you're configuring to, and trying to understand your use case from a client and application perspective. I get asked quite a lot, I don't know what applications my clients are running. That's okay, you should probably do a little research on that. But in the meantime, you can also plan for just rough orders of magnitude of, you know, what I see on my network is X megabits per second per client, or I want to plan for specific throughput per client. You don't have to pick necessarily just an application. You can go in there and select a specific throughput per client target value. The scary piece there is I've only put in, you know, up to 10 megabits per device. I think going anything higher than that, you run a higher risk of shooting yourself in the foot, because honestly, I don't see most clients doing anywhere even near 10 megabits per second on average. You know, you have some clients that peak and they're doing a file transfer for 30 seconds and then they go idle for a long time. So we don't really need to plan for the high data rates like we get advertised typically. So that's a rough overview of what the tool is. We'll go into an example, an actual example with a customer that I had here in a minute. So the example to set it up is I was doing an install for an advertising firm in Manhattan, a very Apple-centric computing environment. You know, spending 15 minutes with a customer just asking very probing questions around, you know, what kind of devices? I see you have a lot of MacBooks. Is that typical for people to have MacBooks? They said, yeah, you know, we're a graphics intensive company. We have a lot of MacBooks. We actually purchase them for our employees on and it's typically every 3 years. We stay up to date on them. And so knowing that this was a modern install, a 3-year life cycle, they do every year, they replace a third of them. I could plan for the last 2 years, models of MacBooks have been 11AC. Maybe the oldest ones that they have, that are a third of those, are still 11N because they're the oldest ones due to be replaced next year. So I plan around 2/3 11AC and maybe 1/3 11N. They support BYOD. They told me, yeah, we don't have a great sense of exactly what the breakout is between what people are bringing in, but we see anecdotally a lot more smartphones on the network than we do tablets. There's probably some sort of skew there, heavier to the smartphone side. And we typically, almost everyone brings something in. And they have some Windows laptops as well, and that was your typical finance department use case where they're doing a lot of Excel spreadsheets and accounting functions. They had a very open and collaborative floor plan, and they also had a very large event space that I'll show you that I call it an inflection point, but you need to understand your average use case throughout an environment, but if there are any aggregation points where people congregate, you need to take those into special consideration because they typically have a higher peak capacity load that you need to plan for. So here's the floor layout. I did not get a clean blueprint from them, so I had what I had to work with. And they had, to kind of give you a feel for what the floor was, they actually were sandwiched between two buildings that had been kind of converted into one. They had a couple of walkways and a brick wall in between. So that's that brick wall right there in the middle. On the right-hand side, they had a very open, collaborative workspace, then with conference rooms at either end of the workspace, some bathrooms and mechanical rooms on the right side, and they had a large open brick atrium in the building as well. But most of it was an open workspace throughout the entire floor. Getting to that. On the left-hand side, they had the large event gathering space. The drywall I've kind of just framed in there, the gray lines is where the actual event space was. And outside of that was an overflow area with some casual tables and seating set up, but they could put in a whole row of portable seating in there for overflow, and they had like three big wide double doors, and the whole room could pretty much open up into the overflow area if they needed to. There's a kitchenette down there as well. So basically, I'm considering this one big event space. The drywall really had minimal attenuation. And then they had a lobby area with a couple of additional conference rooms that really didn't get heavily utilized. It was really just transient use of people walking through in and out of the building and a couple of conference rooms that might have a few users in them, but nothing huge. So the open office area was about 36,000 square feet. They had open seating plan, no cubicles. It was all kind of this just rows of desks laid out in weird pattern. 350 seats, most of them were full with employees. 20 conference rooms, like 10 up top and 10 down below. They had an Apple laptop per employee and one BYOD device per employee. In the event space, it was about 15,000 square feet. 300 seats inside the room and another 200 in the overflow area that they could user capacity. They had two types of things that could go on in that space. They had large events that could support, like they hosted like TED conferences and presentations and things like that. And what they saw there was no laptops. Everybody, you know, might be bringing in mobile devices in that scenario. And they wanted to be able to plan for everybody bringing in a mobile device and being able to get on the network and use internet. And then they would also have large internal meetings with people then bringing in laptops and using them in the large event space for internal meetings. And they actually said, we do have situations where we have almost every employee in that room. They all bring their laptops and we're all doing something at the same time during the meeting, just kind of how their workflow went. So those are, you know, in about 15 to 30 minutes of conversation with the customer, I try to tease this information out of them as best as I can. They were good. They actually, you know, had their existing Trapeze WLAN that they could go look up some statistics out of. They said, well, we don't really look at this much today, but hey, here it is, and we can tell you how many users we have on peak. Which is really great for helping the planning. So to get into that capacity plan, what I ended up actually doing is I ended up planning for these two sides of the building separately. Because with the brick wall in between, and I'll get to some of the heat maps as well, is they were functionally almost completely isolated from one another. Because not only you have the brick wall, you have some mechanical and other building structure in there. The only place we had signal bleed through was in those two breezeways where people could actually walk and roam between the two halves of the two different buildings. So I start with the capacity plan, and I use that as my starting point to figure out how many access points I need. So if I start with, this is the large event space. Yeah.
So you went through in this particular example and you did a lot of capacity planning, at least for the wireless infrastructure side of the house. How did that manifest itself on the routing and switching side of the house for their applications that they're trying to use?
Well, in their case, it was fairly easy because they had a flat layer 2 network. And they actually, with you know potential for 1,000 clients there, they weren't too concerned about having a large contention domain from a broadcast perspective because they really didn't use broadcast or multicast applications. They used a lot of file transfers and graphic design, which I'll get into. They used some SSH real-time traffic, and they were comfortable with doing it as a layer 2 network. We did bring in, we talked about migrating to a layer 3 network and doing layer 3 roaming if we needed to, but we avoided that for the initial install.
I guess I was more questioning about, you've designed, it looked like there was, 30 or so APs on that map. Do they have a 30 gig backhaul to wherever their file servers are at? I mean, if they're talking about doing file transfers and they've got, one file server with a 1 gig uplink, all of this is basically useless, right? Because
right.
You just deployed a 30 gig infrastructure with a 1 gig bottleneck somewhere.
Right. I think their use case was more kind of peer-to-peer. They did a lot of graphic design and they'd ship it around to different people or they'd huddle and go through it and things like that. So I know they had some file servers and things like that, but I think that was more repository. I think a lot of their traffic was actually peer-to-peer sending stuff around between coworkers and or manipulating files in real time between multiple people.
Do you ever see this capacity planner rolling into something that dovetails into a switch side?
Absolutely. I'll get into the capacity plan here, and I try to estimate what the throughput out of an individual AP is, as well as the total aggregate throughput for a space. And so when I do capacity planning, this is why I told you I broke that floor up into two spaces, because functionally I needed two different capacity plans, one for the office environment, one for the event center or event space. And so just to get into it, this client distribution between bands is essentially, I originally had this named the band steering ratio, but then once I started disabling like 2.4 gigahertz radios, I had a mismatch between what I actually needed a band steering ratio to be and actually how many clients would end up on 5 gigahertz because the 5 gigahertz only APs were taking some of that load. So it's actually two functional numbers. And so if you don't disable any radios, your band steering ratio is going to be the same as your client distribution between the frequency bands as well. But you can just put anything in here, right? You can just set a starting point of, 60%, whatever. This is pre-configured because I didn't want to go through it in the demo of just, the manual process of selecting your clients. So, select the client from the list, select the application from the list. Put in how many you have, and it spits out numbers around 2.4 and 5 gigahertz airtime utilization based on the band steering ratio, how many would be on each band, things like that. You come down to the bottom, and let's say my starting point is I don't know what I need to do from an AP capacity perspective in this environment. I plug my numbers in, I do them evenly across the bands, and it says, okay, I need 4 APs. In that large event space. Immediately, my first thought goes to, I can't reuse a 2.4 gigahertz cell in this space because I can't avoid co-channel interference. It is completely impossible, if not from an AP perspective, from a client perspective, because the clients are always going to be omni, and I can't control their power output. So the fourth 2.4 gigahertz radio, I'm sitting here thinking, I can't get capacity out of that radio. I need to limit it. So I check this box, and I want to set a limit on the number of 2.4 gigahertz radios to plan for this space. I'm going to put in 3. I'm going to use 1, 6, and 11, but I don't want to reuse any of them. I recalculate. Okay, I need 4 on 5 gigahertz and 3 on 2.4. And I've also got some growth factored in, about 15% overhead, so if they have any growth in network demand, I can plan for that ahead of time. I also want to plan for all of that growth on 5 gigahertz, so I'll check that box. And so now my final plan here is 4 and 3. And actually, I think when I did it with them, I actually planned for a little bit more growth. So say I want 20% overhead for growth. And so that comes out to 5 radios and 5 gigahertz and 3 and 2.4 in order to meet that bandwidth demand. That's my starting point. If I back up, and I had 4 and 4, what I actually did is I did an AP on a stick survey. And I'm actually a very big proponent of AP on a stick surveys, not for every possible location, but for every possible RF propagation area. I want to understand, in this area, what does my RF look like and how does it propagate through the environment? So what I did is I came up with my initial capacity plan that said four APs. And then I did an AP on a stick in this site, and I tuned the power levels, and I had to tune them just about all the way down that I could on this access point, and I still had propagation throughout that whole event space. There's no way I could limit that. And that's where I got to the point of, I know I can't get the fourth 2.4 gigahertz radio in here. And that's where I went back to the capacity plan and said, I need to limit it to 3 and figure out what my capacity looks like if I limit it to 3. And so that's my iterative approach. I mean, you don't have to consciously do it. It's something that, you know, you work into your methodology and you're natively going to start doing what-if analysis and saying, I just can't do that. It doesn't work. I need to figure out how to make this work. So knowing that that was my RF propagation in the event space, I went back and tweaked the capacity plan and I came up with 5 and 3. I also did propagations for the lobby area and the open workspace. And still, even with very, very low transmit power on the access point, my signal just carried across that whole office. And so immediately, before I even do a capacity plan for the office side of the, I know I'm gonna have probably an issue with serving 350 clients and having too many 2.4 gigahertz radios. I'm gonna have to probably disable some or deploy 1 radio APs. Because the orange areas, if you can see there, are my neg 75 cutoff. And the gray area, the lightest gray area, is my neg 85 dBm cutoff. And this is actually an actual passive survey where I walked around with the AP on a stick. And so I was getting contention from this access point everywhere throughout that office. And I took another one at the other end of the office, and it was about the same.
What power were you in?
I actually had the AP radios turned down to 1 dBm. I did several power levels. I started off, you know, your typical, I'll start out at like maybe 11 dBm, see where it is. The second I took that, I had like a neg 70 all the way to the other end of the office. I'm like, I kept tuning it down and down, and I walked to the other end of the office, still high, tune it down, still high. I got all the way down to 1 dBm, and I'm like, unless I do a picocell deployment, there's no way I'm fitting more than 3 radios probably in this office on 2.4. I did the same thing on 5 gigahertz. It looked very similar, a little bit less, actually, coverage, but not dramatically different. The thing is, we have more channels to work with, so I can actually pack more APs in the area without co-channel interference. So just to run through those, still propagated pretty well, especially from a contention perspective across the entire office. So let me show you the capacity plan then for the office area. So same thing, I started with an 11AC access point. I said, we'll try 40 megahertz channels and see if we can get it to work. Put in my numbers for the office area. I had the 2 different flavors of laptops, 350 seats, remember. So 2/3 of them were 11AC, 1/3 were 11N. And everybody was bringing in at least 1 mobile device. And they knew that they had a higher probability of it being a smartphone than a tablet. So I weighted it about 2/3 to a smartphone and 1/3 to a tablet. Doing the same initial estimate of evenly distributed between the two bands, I came up with 8 access points. Well, showing that you that RF propagation, I know I can't fit 8 2.4 gigahertz radios in that office area. I'm going to, you know, kill my RF contention. So I know I need to tweak that down right away. So let's do the same thing. Some environments, you might be able to get more than three. You might be able to get some reuse in. I didn't think in this office environment I could get any reuse in on 2.4. So I went ahead and limited it again to three. And I planned for all of my future growth in 5 gigahertz. And so now I come up with three access points at 2.4 and 10 in 5 gigahertz. And remember, 5 gigahertz right now, I'm planning around 40 megahertz channels. So the performance is actually better in 5 gigahertz. So taking away 5 2.4 radios, I actually needed fewer 5 gigahertz radios to add. So that's my next point. Okay, can I get 10 and 3 into my RF plan? So on the 5 gigahertz side here, that was my propagation. Here's what it would look like with the capacity plan that I just kind of iterated through and settled on. These are all my active 5 gigahertz radios, and I've got 10 in the office space, 5 in the conference area, and then for the other lobby and conference rooms, I had two. Oh no, excuse me, three. I'll get back to the CCI. The 2.4 gigahertz layout that I came up with then was just three in the office space, the two in the conference center, or in the event space, because the one for the conference rooms over by the lobby actually bled through that the doorway and the construction material over there fairly well, and was my third essentially cell that bleeded over into the event space pretty heavily. Question? I don't think it's on.
So when you're, are you trying to plan your 2.4 and your 5 completely independently and then, all right, well, I'll turn off these radios selectively, or, I mean, how do you approach that? Because depending on propagation and such, there might be times where you're, you know, man, my five gig plan is great when it's laid out this way, you know, and I need to put a 2.4 over here. How do you approach that?
The way I typically approach it is I do my starting point with a capacity plan, and if I don't think I can get a certain, more than a certain number of 2.4 radios typically, I will modify my capacity plan to get to where I think I can get the number of 2.4 radios into the environment, and then I figure out where's the optimal location for the APs that will have 2.4 turned on. And I plot those for my, you know, good coverage that is dual band coverage from an AP. And then I say, well, how many additional 5 gigahertz APs do I need to supplement with additional capacity? And I start planning those around as an overlay on top of kind of my base layer of dual radio APs. And so it's kind of a, just like an iterative process. I can't explain exactly a methodology other than I plot the dual band ones first and then I supplement with single band APs. Because usually those, I'm trying to contain the connection area to an AP anyways. So if I need to supplement, I'll, you know, sprinkle them around where I need, think I need the additional capacity. Does that make sense? Okay. Does anybody do it differently, by the way? How do you do it?
Actually, I just want to say the word you've used over and over again, and I just love it, iterative. You don't get an answer. You get a step. And then you try again, then you get another step, and you get a little closer, and you work your way till you get to a solution that meets all your requirements. It just doesn't jump out and give you an instant answer.
Right, this solution did not, you know, come up and slap me in the forehead. I mean, it, you know, when I saw my AP on a stick predictive, or AP on a stick survey, real survey, immediately I knew I was gonna have a problem in 2.4. I still didn't know exactly where. I mean, it's kind of easy when it's wide open and you can say, I'm only going to get three. It gets a little bit more complicated when you have walls and things and you think you can get some reuse in, then figure out, you know, well, how much reuse could I get into this environment? But that's something that I found just comes through doing it. You do more and more, and it, because this iterative process kind of just gets ingrained in your thinking. You don't even realize you're doing this iterative process because it's just really just a thought process.
So I'll take the question. I think people probably do it. A lot of people have been trained to do it from a signal planning perspective, right? Because that's kind of the way it's been done for a long time. I'm totally on board with the starting from the capacity demand first, because it's that kind of determines, you know, the required coverage as you're showing. But I'm curious, did you get to this because you like to take more of an engineering centric approach, or did you find problems with doing the sort of classic, you know, 2,500 square feet per cell type strategy? Because that seems to, I think a lot of people don't do the engineering centric approach, just deploy at that density, and it kind of seems to work most of the time. And honestly, I think we're getting lucky a lot. But I'm just wondering what your experience is and how you got to this tool from that.
Yeah, I'm pretty much along the same lines as you. I saw a lot of people doing a user count per AP or per radio. I saw a lot of people doing square footage, you know, one AP per 2,500 square feet, 3,000 square feet, depending on, you know, voice, location, data, whatever, right? And to me, I'm one of those people that's a nagging risk to my deployment, that's a factor I haven't accounted for, which could make my customer upset and the network not work right. And I think we are getting lucky a lot of the time, but I think we also have a large influx of devices now, where even if you have one AP per 3,000 square feet, you might still not be meeting your capacity requirements adequately, because that's fundamentally an RF concept. It's not a capacity concept. Yes, we want smaller cell sizes when we have higher capacity, but that's not the driving force behind determining your capacity. Like I said earlier, you know, if everybody in here was doing a certain application or use case, and I was planning just one AP per 3,000 square feet, I could be completely off. So I want to have that barometer of where am I at from coverage to high density. And you've covered the high density in stadiums very well, which is completely a different methodology, by the way, when you're trying to pack as many cells in. I use this for your typical corporate enterprise school wireless network, where they don't have the budget to try to pack in as many cells as possible. They have budgetary constraints, and they want to actually meet their use case in a cost-effective manner, but still be assured that it's going to work for what they need to do. And they just don't know where they're at. And, you know, I go talk to customers, and you know, one AP per four classrooms, and I'm like, yeah, you probably are a little light. And then I go to others, and they're one AP per classroom, and I'm like, you're going to be turning off some radios. So, you know, they just need to know where they're at in that scale.
The radio management algorithms aren't a replacement for this, for what you're doing with the capacity. I'm just curious what your thoughts are on modern radio management algorithms and how they fit into this.
I think a lot of the modern radio management, to me, it comes down to the vendor. I think some do it better than others. Some do it a lot better than others, actually. So I don't want to call out names. I don't want to get into, you know, vendor wars. But depending on the vendor I'm deploying, I would either trust it or I wouldn't. And that's just from my own practical experience. It does not solve the where do I place APs, how many APs do I need. But it can help you make sure you don't run into heavy co-channel interference by doing transmit power control. And the other thing is, during your survey process, you should get a baseline of, you know, what power levels you should be expecting in your environment. And if you see, you can set thresholds typically in some of them in the RM where you can say, don't go above this level, right? And so it can lead into exactly your configuration for RM. So the CCI on 2.4 was actually really good when I got done with my survey, because guess what? I didn't reuse any channels. Practically. The only areas I had some overlap were in those breezeways between buildings. I think I actually have to back up for the 5 gigahertz. That 5 gigahertz actually ended up a little bit worse, because I wasn't using the Uni 2 E-band for DFS. I had like 6 40 megahertz channels. And the way the APs were laid out, I actually did have to reuse some channels. So if you take, let's say, the office space, the top 6 up there, I had to start reusing channels with the bottom 4. And so what I did is I used static channels in this case. And I said, the one that's in the conference room up there, I'm going to reuse way down here at the other end of the office to make sure I minimize CCI as much as possible, and vice versa. And the one in the bottom left of the office was opposite the one in the top right. And the one in the conference room in the bottom was opposite the one in the open space, open floor plan up above. So I felt with 6 channels, I'd have a little bit of co-channel interference, but it wasn't too heavy. and I could get away with it. Because if I actually ran the capacity plan and I redid it with 20 megahertz channels with their use case, my AP count, my radio count in 5 gigahertz dramatically went up. And so even if I used 20 megahertz channels, I would have had put more APs in that would have caused just as much, if not more, co-channel interference to meet their bandwidth requirements that they wanted to target to. So that's kind of the what-if scenario is go back and run some scenarios to figure out 20, 40 megahertz channels, probably never 80. So just to recap, network performance is reliant on contention delay, which is dependent on two things, co-channel interference, and what I focused on a lot today, which was your airtime demand within a channel or within a cell. Airtime saturation occurs different points for different WMM access categories. Know what you have on your network from a QoS perspective. If you're voice heavy, it makes a big difference. And I'm actually, you know, one of the things is I'm very glad that most video traffic doesn't get tagged video. It probably actually, I can support higher client densities because it's in the best effort queue. So I actually like that for the most part. Capacity is measured by airtime demand of clients. You should design for both capacity and coverage, and I recommend an iterative approach. And if you want to follow my methodology or give it a shot, download the Revolution Wi-Fi Capacity Planner. The user guide's in there that goes through this methodology as well. And so I just, you know, I appreciate your time today, and I'm looking forward to discussion and hearing how everybody else does it as well. Are we out for time? We're out. I can take your question afterward, though.
Okay.